In the fifth episode of our Momentum series titled How to Augment, Insert and Interface, my partner and husband Andrea Pagnes, artist and author, talks with the artist Stelarc about his major performance works and his vision and understanding of the human body. The two artists elegantly slide through the sciences of biology, physics, and engineering to philosophy, confronting existential questions about notions of space, time, freedom, and ultimately life and death. They examine and interrogate representations and replicas, technology, and the illusion of agency. They see the human in an evolutionary oscillation between the actual and the virtual, within comparative anatomies and the possibilities and limits of the biological body. Stelarc is a Cyprus-born Australian performance artist whose works focus on augmenting and amplifying the capabilities of the human body. Most of his projects are centered on his concept that the human body is obsolete. Stelarc pioneered the frontiers of the human body, using his own body as both a medium of expression and as a host for a work of art. Artist, phenomenon, and articulate thinker, Stelarc continues to generate new scenarios, speculating about the body in the technological terrain that it now inhabits. His radical performances often involve sophisticated technological devices, prosthetics, robotics, the internet, virtuality, and biotechnology integrated with his body. In numerous performances, he has suspended himself in flesh hook suspensions, and in 2006, he had an ear surgically constructed and cell grown on his left arm. In 2010, he was awarded the Ars Electronica Golden Nica Hybrid Arts Prize. In 2015, he received the Australia Council's Emerging and Experimental Arts Award. Stelarc's artwork is represented by the Scott Livesey Galleries in Melbourne, Australia. Welcome to the Momentum of Autumn 2021.
Dear Stelarc, since the late 60s, you have been performing with your biological and digital body. In your exceptional artistic career, you have explored alternate anatomical and perceptual architectures, evolutionary organic structures, and how those different operational architectures enable us to become aware and interact with the world in such different ways. You engineered prosthetic and robotic interfaces to perform with. You have surgically constructed and cell-grown an ear on your arm to possibly function as a transmitting device to communicate with other people in other places. You constructed immersive artificial virtual spaces for other people to navigate and experience, as we are expected to increasingly inhabit mixed realities. You conceived complex art projects to actualize ideas, to experience and discover aspects of your own body that you wouldn't otherwise, coining the concept of the body as contemporary chimera, where biology, technology, and virtuality converge. For we cannot imagine the body purely physiological. Your performances are also aesthetic gesture to unfold the possibility of hybrid human-machine systems. This unique artistic path you are still tracing begins with taking physical risks to push the biological boundaries of the human body, your body, within certain limitation, with your legendary hook suspension performances, to extend human sensation, perception, eventually exposing the obsolescence of the human body. What were some specific experiences with the suspensions?
It was certainly physically difficult to realize the suspension performances, but the experiences were very different depending on the orientation of the body, the location of the performance, and the circumstances surrounding realizing it. Most occurred in remote or private galleries where there was no invited audience. But there were a few performances that had much larger audiences because they were performed in public spaces, in city spaces. Most were statically suspended, but with others the body was swung, spun, or propelled. In the Tamura Gallery, for example, with the sitting, swaying event for rock suspension, the body was suspended in a sitting position, counterbalanced by a ring of rocks, one rock for each insertion point. There were 18 rocks in total. The body was gently swaying from side to side, generating random oscillations in the rocks. There were 9 people invited as they were needed to lift the 18 rocks, lowering the body close enough to the floor for the cables to be cut. The duration of the performance, as with all of the other suspensions, was not predetermined. For the rock suspension, the performance ended when the telephone rang in the gallery, sort of breaking that sort of meditative moment. For the seaside suspension for Wind and Waves, the body was suspended side on, looking out to sea, on an outcrop of rocks about 300 metres from shore. The supporting structure wedged into the rocks was unstable. There was a strong wind and the waves crashed over the body. It was all a very unsettling experience. There were a group of fishermen who were fishing before we arrived. They were fishing during the performance, and they were still fishing when we left. With the street suspension over East 11th Street in New York, the preparations were done in a fourth floor room. A steel cable was then strung across the street to the fire escape stairs of the other building on the other side of the street. And when everything was ready, the body rolls out of the window, stopping about halfway across. I had a good view of the police cars that arrived in about 5 minutes. The performance was supposed to be for 30 minutes, but was terminated after 12. The performance ended when the police pulled me back through the window and I was arrested, not for a display of public nudity, nor for performing some sadomasochistic action, but rather for being a danger to the public. For example, I might have fallen on someone. The city suspension in Copenhagen proved to be the suspension with the largest audience, as it was part of an international theatre festival. Here the police actually assisted with the crowd and the traffic below. The body was hoisted almost 60 metres high above the Royal Theatre by a large crane. The body then was shuttled to the end of the crane arm and was rotated 3 times before being lowered down. After about 30 metres high above the surrounding buildings, all I could hear was the whooshing of the wind, the whirring of the crane motors, and the creaking of the skin. The suspensions are not meant to generate any meaning. Rather, they're actions of bodily sensation. They neither require any explanation nor interpretation. The realization with these performances was not that they were expressions of human prowess or shamanistic displays or yogic examples of control, but rather that the body is not only inadequate, but radically obsolete in both form and function and operation.
Representation is the action taken on behalf of someone or the state of being thus represented. It can also be defined as a description of something in a particular metonymic way. For instance, when in rhetoric, the cause describes the effect or the matter of the object. In philosophical terminology, abstraction is the mental process in which ideas are distanced from things they refer to, seeking a particular fluidity of experience concerning the object itself as a problematizing matter. Technology in art has the potential to transform representation into abstraction. For example, in online live streaming performances, the internet and digital tools take away or dematerialize the original corporeal dimension of the performer. The performance becomes something else, akin to an abstraction, allowing one to read, interpret the same original differently from what it actually is. If abstraction helps identify the commonly understood characteristics of defined conceptions, isolating standard features between different elements is essential to retain only the relevant information of the designated concept. Technology also helps to propose a different interpretation of an original beyond how it appears to the senses by using virtuality, robotics, or apply prostheses of a different kind. This way, the representation of an original thing results from an experience that one has had of the designated original itself, allowing further knowledge and understanding. But for instance, the qualities and the conditions of a body technological replica of an original, like a virtual spectral presence or a zombie avatar, appear as forms that we perceive as immaterial and are not referable to anything other than the memory of the original, like was saying that the computer images of the performer's body appear as locums of cold light that stand in the way of an infinite vacuum, the material cyberspace. Also, holographic images define a presence in the absence of semiotic signs and therefore meaning, but in the end they are paradigmatic deconstructive gestures that testify to a deficiency, a lack, an insufficiency, a decompensation, a disappearance of the physical. Replacing the original, they become its simulacrum. But we don't need simulacra. Avatars and holographic projection resembling the truth may produce an alienation, even disturbing. They can be considered gimmicks that reveal unique aspects of an already known reality, because technological construction is not hidden. If anything, what is alarming is that avatars and holograms could represent the point of exhaustion of the image of the original thing they refer to, since it merges with it to return it immaterial, thus emptying it of its intrinsic characteristics and qualities. There is a sort of mysterious fascination in all this. Avatars and holograms of living and existing beings or existed conversely transform the original into an interposed provisional double, a transient impression, a digital ghost that complicates the linearity of that thin thread that connects life to death and traces their border, which, however, is now blurred. In your performances that address these topics, using avatars and prostheses, you go beyond the concept of replica and extend the operational possibilities of the virtual and the prosthetic itself. Can you kindly explain through some example, like the Movatar performance and the prosthetic head?
I'm not so interested in body replicas in themselves, whether robotic or virtual, but rather the interface and interaction between the body and its other, whether machinic or phantom. The Movatar performance was realised at Casula Powerhouse in Sydney in 2000. It was a kind of inverse motion capture system. Instead of the body animating its avatar, here an avatar imbued with genetic algorithms that altered its actions over the duration of the performance could access a physical body and perform with it in the real world via the upper body exoskeleton. It was also a split body experience with the upper body avatar actuated, whilst the lower body of the artist able to perform with his own agency. Other related projects are the prosthetic head and the articulated head. The prosthetic head is a 12,000 polygon mesh with the artist's skin wrapped around the 3D model. It has a database, a conversational system, and real-time lip-syncing, with enough morph targets to generate facial expressions. The prosthetic head can speak to the person who interrogates it. It is a very large head, projected 5 meters in height, and occupies a cuboid space. When you enter the gallery, you literally become immersed in the headspace of the artwork. As well as responding to general questions, the head can compose its own short poems and creatively generate song-like sounds. An iteration of this digital entity was the articulated head, which has a physical presence with a monitor displaying the artist's scanned head. It is attached to the end of a 6 degree of freedom robot arm. So here, the virtual behavior head is augmented by the physical robot articulations. The articulated head has an awareness software generated by sensor systems that can do vision tracking and sound location. Another head project, but a very different one, was the partial head, realised for the Heidi Museum of Modern Art in Melbourne in 2005. The artist's head was scanned, as was a hominid skull, and a digital transplant of the human over the hominid was done. It was a kind of composite third face. This data was used to 3D print a polymer scaffold, which was seeded with living cells. So this partial head was a partial portrait of the artist, partially living until it got contaminated and had to be fixed in formaldehyde for the remainder of the exhibition. The prosthetic head, the articulated head, and the partial head can also be considered as partial portraits of the artist.
I would like to ask you, how do you see the discourse about the pervasiveness of surveillance, which then refer to the issue of autonomy, on the defense of one's independence from the machine and from those who govern them? The rapidity of the technological development in recent decades has caused a drastic change in the perception of reality. Traditional certainties have come to fall. Factual truth has become summarily one of the many possible options deriving from the same reality's countless translations. All these asymmetrical realities are like avatars of the actual configuration of the truth, whose trace and aspect have progressively disappeared, leaving space to a technologically saturated universe made of misleading images of reality. The problem of disinformation and misleading images move parallel to visibility. Visibility, the state of seeing and being seen, has become a matter of a global political urgency, catalyzed by developments and the increase in pervasive surveillance. The computers dictate certain constraints. The empty spaces we need to fill in with our ID signifiers easily act and stolen. In an increasingly complex world, restrictions, rules and regulation increase for people to interact, exist and function within the rich domain of web operations. Thus, I wonder how to develop strategies in both the public and private spheres, not so much to avoid being monitored, but to shed light on issues that are deliberately kept hidden from our eyes or intentionally neglected to serve particular interest. How something genuine can be made visible in a universe of supersaturated images, or what it would mean to vanish in an era of near total surveillance. What artistic performative practices could most inspire to challenge and resist the current surveillance modalities in a time when surveillance and data harvesting have become widely accepted as prevalent features in both the public and private spheres? Essentially, do we actually need all this increasing amount of surveillance on our bodies, in public spaces, on the internet?
Well, we need more surveillance, not less. Not in public spaces, but rather in our private physiological spaces. Between 1973 and 1975, I made three films of the inside of the left and right bronchi of my lungs, stomach and colon. A total of 3 meters of internal space was probed. At the time that I was performing by acoustically amplifying body signals like brain waves, heartbeat and muscles, I was simultaneously probing the inside of the body. The body was experienced not simply as a surface of skin, but rather as an internal architecture of structures, spaces, and circulatory systems. 20 years later, for the fifth Australian sculpture triennial, whose theme was site-specific works, instead of a sculpture for a public space, I decided to design a sculpture for a private physiological space, a sculpture for the inside of my stomach. Closed as a capsule, it could be safely inserted down the esophagus into the inflated stomach cavity. The insertion was documented with a medical endoscope. Inside the stomach, the sculpture could open and close, extend and retract. It had a flashing light and a beeping sound. This was a simple machine choreography inside a soft organ of the body. The body here is not a site for inscription or a site for the psyche, but simply a site for a sculpture, the body as a host for a work of art. These experiences of probing and inserting technology inside the body led to a realization that micro and nanoscale components could be incorporated inside the body. In fact, all technology in the future might be invisible because it'll be inside the body. We have no adequate early alert warning system for problems that occur at a cellular level. When the symptoms surface, it's generally too late. The cancer has metastasized. Micro and nanoscale sensors and machines could detect and monitor and even correct pathological changes in temperature, chemistry, and blockages in circulatory systems. So yes, we need more surveillance, but for the inside of the human body. And this recolonization of the body with nanoscale bots and sensors might perhaps allow the redesigning of the body, atoms up, inside out, the process would not be felt and would be invisible until the changes surface to a skin level.
If an enclosed space's characteristics can be precisely listed, an open transit liminal space or soliquid space, referring to Zygmunt Bauman's idea of our software-based modernity, like any ideal performance space intended for movement, expression and communication, with the pandemic has now become the space of stillness and deadlock. In this space, time is as if suspended, exhausted, and as performers, we can imagine being beyond this space, in a time that will perhaps be never. Precisely because performance is transient, it allows thinking of intermediate spaces so that performance is not reduced to a mere entertainment product, but becomes a political act of repositioning oneself. Yet the word space already contains a paradox. On the one hand, it refers to demarcation, on the other to infinity. When we perform, we create imaginary landscapes that define, represent, or generate new identities outside society's normative frameworks. We develop personal spaces that flow into public ones, since they have a normalizing power with a substantial psychological and social impact. Public spaces are mainly based on rational principles and rooted in economic motivations. Likewise, virtual space is too, but it is simulated and exists only potentially. Also, the internet can be thought of as an intermediate space or immaterial landscape. However, with the electric source removed, the game ends. The immaterial, the intangible, falls again in the dark, in a void. The notion of immaterial space poses new questions to every attempt to answer within the same discourse. For example, if the immaterial can be experienced, at least in part, with the intellect, both in the performative and virtual space, is it preposterous to say to experience it with the body? Yet how can we clearly discern the differences between private and public space about the body and its interaction today, when faced with the difficulty of deciphering an increasingly complex reality?
Yes, we can discern differences between personal and public spaces in reference to the body and its interactions. But we also need to include that the body now inhabits collapsed spaces of being propelled by fast machines and computes the minutely measured spaces of its instruments. And well, the reality is that we now navigate from physical nanoscales to virtual non-places, to cosmological deep time. The body inhabits increasingly abstract realms of the highly hypothetical and of streaming subjectivity. The body has become simultaneously more and less than the sum of its hyperlinks. Timothy Morton speaks about hyperobjects. The body itself has become a kind of hyperhuman, in that it performs in distributed and extended spaces and speeds in a multiplicity of mixed realities. We are increasingly haunted by our proliferating phantom bodies that flicker on and off online as if glitches in biological time. As a body, as a subjective being, I find seductive the Kantian notion that time and space are not actual substances nor properties of substances, but rather the way we represent the world in distances and durations. Space and time are not actual, but ideal, a priori properties. But actor network theory and object-oriented ontologies go beyond Kantian subjectivity to realms of flattened ontologies where the human is not privileged over other actors and objects. In actor network theory, your qualities, your capabilities are the result of an actor's interaction in the network. And with object-oriented ontology, this provides a more enigmatic definition of an object. One can't understand an object reductively, neither from its parts, nor holistically or idealistically from its relations or effects. Objects withdraw from the human, having their own existence. They cannot simplistically be understood in the Heideggerian sense of being ready at hand. Philosophy is interesting when it challenges and undermines rather than affirms our experiences of the world.
Space-time in physical science is the concept that recognizes the union of space and time, first proposed by the mathematician Hermann Minkowski in 1908 as a way to reformulate Albert Einstein's theory of relativity of 1905. It is commonly assumed that finite lengths of space and finite intervals of time are infinitely divisible. We tend to make predictions assuming that what is happening now can continue in the future, rather than considering a progressive change related to a sequence of events. Also, it does not offer a reason to believe that the current situation will continue beyond the present. When there is insufficient knowledge of the causes of a specific state of circumstances, any prediction is futile. Thus, to consider the idea of the future, we cannot merely assume a relational continuity between past, present, and the time that will be. In this way, we would establish that human beings act on hypotheses drawn from experience in reality. In principle, it is conceivable that the future may be different from the past. Now, artificial intelligence can aspire to certainty, but it cannot achieve a rightness in envisioning the future, same as any scientific theory. And even if historical knowledge and reading the present allows any form of prediction, and even more so when artificial intelligence comes into play, what future should we talk about when the future has not arrived yet? If we ponder how today politics are becoming increasingly authoritarian, we may predict a near future with particular specificity. We may refer to moments that already occurred over time, likewise saying that history between courses and resorts always returns to where it all began. We may say that the near future is precisely here and now, because the short-term future consists of events shaped by those same circumstances from observing current ones. Yet, even though the short-term future will resemble the past, shaped by causes and effects of similar cases, which, however new, can be associated with predicting the near future, it is perhaps impossible to establish precisely how much time can pass from today to the near future. Still, it does not mean to nurture expectations, always present time points, for the future, and that, if wrong, they can be hopefully corrected. Historical knowledge and artificial intelligence reading data of the past may allow us to conceive limited but practically useful predictions and anticipations. However, the past be useless as a guide. There can be no way of knowing if the future will be like the past. Little can be learned from history when interpreted by the way too general, since all events are unique. The assumption that past, present, and future are not separable implies they regularly contaminate one another and that parts of them coagulate, forming an infinite present that has always been here. Only it is not linear, so it sometimes escapes ordinary human understanding. Conversely, they may allow someone to predict which connection between past, present, and future should be strengthened for a progressive constructive change, transforming the weight of existent into regenerative rather than degenerative.
What future should we talk about when the future has not yet arrived, or for that matter, that there is a future at all? Perhaps it's another way of constructing all the possibilities generated by our curiosity, our desires, our hopes and expectations. Or if we can speak of a future at all, it brings to mind William Gibson's observation that the future is already here, but it's just not evenly distributed. And well, we can speculate on scenarios of what might change, what might happen, but a future is not a future if it is not of the unexpected. A future is not simplistically what occurs of necessity, but rather constructed of contingency. And what artists do best is to generate contestable futures, possibilities that can be personally performed, experienced, and perhaps more meaningfully articulated, possibly appropriated, but more likely discarded. This artist performs with a posture of indifference, indifference as opposed to expectation. The performance should unfold in its own time, with its own rhythm.
As a body-based performance artist, I understand reality with and through my body and its alleged manifestations, work, sweat, pleasure, pain, which often have been defamed compared to the subtle bodies and its alleged manifestation, soul, mind, thought, intellect, knowledge. I do not tend to rely on this clear-cut separation, for I believe that the human body is an active part of the cognitive process as a whole, in its totality, the only tool parameter to read reality, albeit its reading will always be partial. In our practice, hours of VestAndPage, nothing creates itself from nothing, ex nihilo nihil. Nothing is autopoietic or self-organizing. A work also springs from collaborative processes. The word collaboration is dynamic, responsive, situated, as the word freedom. Both terms drive me to consider how we as artists connect and how we as humans connect to nature, society, other sentient beings, the non-human environment, human-made systems, time. Eventually, how to represent all that in our art projects, often conceived as spaces for artistic communities, inspiring other live artists to strengthen each other and become multi-contextual. Indeed, we become when we are together. Even in the digital age, performers still need their own physical body to create work and situation and gatherings in shared spaces. Just as in everyday life, the human being cannot ignore the relationship with their body, the physical space, and the bodies of the others. Life is the art of necessary encounters to give to and learn from the other. I believe that more than ever, given the current situation of increased precariousness and political turmoil, artists need to join forces and creating spaces to nurture freedom, that one that sparkles from our bodies when we act not as isolated individuals.
Well, it's necessary to understand that speaking about my body or your body is simply designating this body or that body. Saying you have a relationship with your body perpetuates notions of internal agency and the Cartesian split of mind and body. We speak as an I or a you for convenience in language of much more complex interactions and feedback loops between this body and other bodies and objects. Ludwig Wittgenstein reminds us that thinking need not be located inside our heads. Thinking happens with the lips that we speak, with the fingers that we write or type. This body is a physiological, phenomenological, interacting and aware body in the world. To be an intelligent agent, we need to be both embodied and embedded and appropriately responding in the world. What is important is not what is inside you or me, but rather what happens between us in the medium of language that we communicate, in the culture that we have been conditioned, and in the social institutions that we operate in at this point in time in our history. So, how a body performs and how it expresses its freedom is highly constrained and largely predetermined. One can define a body by the encounters, collisions, and collaborations it has with other bodies. Having said that, particular bodies in particular places at particular times are not as important as we, as individuated bodies, would like to imagine in our lifetimes. Birth and death are evolutionary strategies to shuffle genetic material and for population control. Our contributions are contingent and contestable. They are not of necessity. We contribute and then we become part of the cultural archive of our species. But we are curious creatures that generate desires to be something other, to be in excess of our biology. What is important in this age of information overload is not freedom of ideas, but rather freedom of form, freedom to modify your body. Initially with prosthetic attachments and implants, but also with surgical and possible genetic intervention. This bipedal breathing body with a 1400 cubic centimeter brain in this form and with these functions is not only inadequate, but profoundly obsolete. The human body is vulnerable to bacteria and viruses. It is soft and easily damaged. It fatigues often. Its organs malfunction, and it has a limited lifespan of about 80 years in good health before it quickly deteriorates and then dies. And that's a problem if you're already 70. So, do we accept the biological status quo, or do we consider its redesign?
The pandemic has provoked a U-turn in our lives and ways of thinking. It has shaken the anthropocentric view at its essence. The human being is not the central element of existence at large, while the reality is an entity in constant evolution, not subjected to our choices, but carried out through dynamic forces we do not fully understand. Humankind, indeed, is beautiful, but also weak, fragile, unprepared, vanquishable. If, on the one hand, our interactions are increasingly mediated, contaminated by the machine, and the digital make us discover something not known before every day passing, on the other, discovery creates satisfaction, and satisfactions create addictions. This growing dependence on technology causes new imbalances, considering the lack of technological development in several countries. Yet, a technological singularity's prediction is that we may reach a hypothetical moment in time at which technological growth becomes uncontrollable and irreversible, resulting in unforeseeable changes to human civilization. Hungarian philosopher Laszlo Ropoloi, analyzing the complex nature of the internet and the impact of its use on human life, argues that technology as an ontological Janus face. It produces both things and representations, but in that representations have become dominant over the thingly products in the most important technologies of our age, complicating our perception and reading of the reality and the human nature.
One can argue that the transition from hominid to human occurs when we begin collaborating, communicating, and constructing artifacts, instruments, and machines. So the human body was always a prosthetic body, always more than its biological self. And at a time when the individual body can be threatened existentially by fatally being infected by viruses, the human species is confronted by the more pervasive and invasive ontological risk of contamination by its techno-digital artifacts and entities. The body now is literally being invaded by technology. If that technology is biocompatible in both scale and substance, the body welcomes technology. Electronic circuitry can safely inhabit the tissue structures and spaces of the human. So, in this age of body hacking, gene mapping, prosthetic augmentation, organ swapping, face transplants, synthetic skin, what it means to be a body, what it means to be human, and what generates aliveness and agency becomes problematic.
We have been used to building environments to live inside, and from which we can absent ourselves. Factories, automated distribution centers, and credit institutions can create absence by replacing human workers with robots, computers, and software. Same for any places to perform. Theater, black boxes, and white cubes, or any building converted into an art space, albeit temporary, or built new for the purpose. There have already been performances in which the performer is absent, replaced by non-human machines, or better said, present in their absence, since they must still conceive the work and activate the performance scenario. Perhaps performer's absence can be interpreted as a possible strategy of contemporary performing arts to reflect on decentralization and the eventual disappearance of the human being. For example, performances in which the human remains present but in a ghostly state, replaced by performing machinery. In the Matrix, the human physical body is constrained, anesthetized, dormant, used just as a power source, a battery for the machines harvesting human mental energy and creativity, because they cannot create their own. But that combined with a form of fusion, they find all the energy they would ever need to exist and dominate. In the holographic and digital replacement of the performer, the spectral double of the human becomes a functional component to cyberspace, post-organic and post-human context. My point is that the machinic replacement of the human creates a phenomenological situation of appearance paradoxically more potent than reality, while alluding to the possible absence of humanity in industrial and cultural production places, and perhaps planet Earth. I think that the notions of presence versus absence of the performer can stimulate alternative forms of knowledge, accretive reflection around anthropocentrism, to question our relationship with technology and the process of becoming.
Perhaps the human species is also destined to disappear. If so, we perhaps need to plan for an elegant exit. But in the meantime, we need to manage the mixed modes of our operation. We need to seamlessly slide between the biological, the machinic, and the virtual. We need to perform simultaneously in offline and online worlds, between the actual and the virtual. What it means to be human is our social, cultural, machinic, and computational augmentations. As this oscillation between the actual and the virtual accelerates, it will increasingly become meaningless to distinguish between the two. Having said that, perhaps intelligence will not reside in the biological or in the machine, but rather in virtual and viral entities that operate and replicate with the speed of light within our electronic media. So electronic media become the incubator for artificial intelligence. In fact, the first signs of an alien life may well come from this planet.
If bodily presence is evidence of being alive at times, then absence is a state to embody to stay alive. I am away but still breathing, standing. It sounds like a contradiction in term, but critically it proves to be somehow valid in examining the present situation. Philosophers like Derrida have attempted to think beyond the binary distinction of presence and absence to more technologically informed valuation of the being. If cyborg and digital bodies indicate the integration of the human being with the machine, from this perspective, it can be said that technological forms usually related to notion of absence are assimilated into being. And if the cyborg and digital bodies have modified new ways of thinking about representation and being and the relative concepts of absence and presence, do the physical human body benefit from it, or will it gradually lose importance, almost dematerialize, disappear in the end?
We need to rethink embodiment and question whether a biological body is adequate. If a body has access to streaming data, if a body can have access to online archives, if a body can reliably retrieve memories, if a body can sense and experience a wider electromagnetic spectrum, and if a body can maintain its performance and extend its lifespan, then perhaps we should consider such a body. Marshall McLuhan indicated that technology is the external organs of the body. We have evolved as these soft biological bodies with internal organs to adequately function in the natural world. Now we need to engineer additional external organs to better interface with the technological terrain that we now inhabit. With cyborg and digital bodies, the body is in excess. It goes beyond the biological, both in form and in function, both in offline and online worlds. They provide alternate anatomical architectures to perform in mixed and augmented realities. These are not about enhancement, but rather they are certainly experiments that interrogate what a body is and how a body operates in the world and in electronic media. The biological body is a body that generates presence being in the here and now, in other words, with physical presence and particular location. With the biological body, it is absent if it is not materially present in proximity. In the digital world, our physical bodies become phantom entities potentially ever present in that they are accessible at any time online.
Bodily presence, time, space, and direct communication are at the core of performance art practice. What are your thoughts on art and performance?
Well, this is my definition of art. Art happens in the slippage between intention and actual outcome, where the accidental and the unpredictable can be incorporated. Art, by its very process, should be both surprising to the artist as well as its audience. If it isn't, it's probably not very interesting art. I decided to become a performance artist when I discovered that I was a bad painter in art school. That's not a trivial response, but of course, in addition, I was always interested in Darwinian theory and comparative anatomies, and especially the evolutionary architecture of the human body and how the body operates, interacts, and becomes aware in the world. And I was always envious of dancers who use their body as an expression of their art. Performance is not primarily about the visual and the metaphor. Performance is not only time-based, but also site-specific, and thus it's ephemeral in its essence. It's about a particular body performing in a particular place at a particular time, rather than being merely informative. It's about intuition and intensity of affect. Rather than requiring explanation, it is about evoking experiences. It might be structured, but it is certainly not scripted. And as a performance artist, you have to take the physical consequences for your ideas. Performance art can be messy, it can be political, it can be disturbing psychologically. It can be pornographic, it can be physically difficult, and can even be dangerous. Rather than being affirming as an expression of skill, rather than being formal as an expression of design, performance art is, on the other hand, a radical relationship of the body and the other, of this body with other bodies. It's not about providing answers. Performance art is unsettling, generating ambivalence, ambiguity, and anxiety.
Performance art has the property of lasting for a short time. It reminds us that the state or condition of the human being is intrinsically temporary, transient. This also implies a crucial discourse, how to document and archive performances, the immaterial and the ephemeral they represent. And also if reenacting a performance is meaningful or is a paradoxical or rhetorical exercise to bring back past moments to life, which is impossible.
If a performance is an ephemeral act, realized by a particular person, and that occurs in a particular place and in a particular historical time that expresses a certain zeitgeist, then recreating a performance in the future is particularly problematic. What would be the purpose of re-performing the events of Viennese actionists, or Chris Burden being shot in the arm or nailed to a Volkswagen, or Vito Acconci biting his arm, or Marina and Ule's life-threatening bow and arrow rest energy action, or replicating the facial surgeries of Orlan, or the bloodletting of Franco B, or for that matter, this artist being suspended, counterbalanced by a ring of rocks. Some of these performances can be represented by a still image, whilst more complex or durational actions are best encapsulated in video. But whoever documents the performance frames it in their own particular and peculiar way, and this was always problematic for the artist, for me. But from the mid-1990s, I decided to position multiple cameras around and above the body, constructing an aesthetic surveillance system for the performance. This augments a small camera attached to my arm and also attached to the end of an industrial robot arm. And this automates panning, tilting, and zooming motions, generating a much more cinematic mixing and switching of the video, which was done live during the performance with tilt sensors on my head, arms, and legs. So the artist not only physically performed, but his involuntary muscle-stimulated movements involuntarily switched the camera views that were projected on a screen either beside or above the artist and the robot. Data and images from the computer interface were also incorporated in the video mix. So there was no distinction anymore between the performance and its documentation.
The evolution of robotics has expanded the field of sculpture, both concerning the body and the environment. I remember when I visited the Audi factory, a technological Jurassic Park populated by robots and machines, substituting the workers' human body. If a factory as a production site relies more and more on technology and can do without a human being, it may result in an empty, disturbing, dystopian place. What will it mean to be human in a world populated by increasingly sophisticated technologies?
Neither utopian expectations nor dystopian visions are of any consequence. What it means to be human is what it means to be prosthetically augmented, oscillating between the machinic and the virtual. Prosthetic attachments, exoskeletons, and implants are engineered body parts. We should not have a nostalgia for a biological body. It is inadequate in form and in function, and in the technological terrain of precise and powerful machines, there is a post-evolutionary necessity to consider the redesign of the human body. But the future of intelligent life may no longer reside in genetically manipulated biological bodies, hybrid human-machine systems, or even dexterous and algorithmically amplified robots. On the contrary, intelligent life may well reside in viral code replicating and transmitting at electronic speed in the smooth spaces of virtuality.
To my eye, the use of robotics in your performances responds not because of a scientific choice, but instead to a philosophical one. That is, the human capacity to influence one's functioning and the courses of events by one's action, in short, in being with the ability to act, where the performer, the human, the machine, the robot, concur together to denote the exercise and manifestation of this capacity. Perhaps, can you elaborate on the robot performances a bit more?
With the Edge Biennial in London in 1992, I performed with a large industrial robot arm. A video camera was attached to the end of the arm, allowing cinematic pans, tilts and rotations of the camera around the body as part of the live performance. There was a counterpoint between the pre-programmed choreography of the robot and the repetitive and involuntary movements of the body using muscle stimulation. The body was positioned within the task envelope of the robot that was gyrating around and above it. This began a series using industrial robots. There were iterations of these scanning robot performances in Linz for Ars Electronica, Sydney for Ticea, Quebec for Le Corps Amplifié, Helsinki for the Mu Media Festival, Rotterdam for V2, Munich at Mufthalle, and in Lyon for the third Biennial of Contemporary Art. Exoskeleton was engineered when I was a visiting artist for Hamburg City. With the assistance of F-18, the robot was completed in 1997, robust enough to support the artist's weight. The upper body exoskeleton enabled the artist to select the walking motions of the robot. With arm gestures, the robot could walk forwards and backwards with a ripple gait, sideways with a tripod gait. It can squat, it could stand, it can stomp, and it could turn on the spot. It's a powerful pneumatically actuated machine. The performance is simply taking a robot for a walk, a kind of hybrid human-machine system. It was the first performance that I did with my clothes on. I did at first try to stand on the robot naked, but the metal legs striking the concrete floor were sending shockwaves up my legs and spine. It was decided the only way to perform safely on the robot was to wear shockproof boots. Upon further thought, I decided it would be prudent to wear clothes as well, much to the disgust of my friends. The muscle machine is a 5-meter diameter walking system actuated by pneumatic rubber muscles antagonistically bundled. Encoders on the hip and leg joints meant lifting one leg up actuated 3 robot legs to lift and swing forward. By stepping up and down, the robot could be actuated to move. The performance was simply translating human bipedal gait into a 6-legged insect-like locomotion. What is becoming apparent is that increasingly the difference between biologically being alive and machine aliveness is blurring. In other words, as machine kinematics become more complex, machine vocabularies of movement become increasingly seductive. And increasingly more captivating kinematics generates illusions of agency. Although it has to be admitted that an illusion of agency is increasingly not any different to agency itself. Note that the philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche asserts that agency is assigned retroactively. What we should assign importance to is the act itself.
You have constructed more extended operational systems and conceived a more complex collective body with your interactive performances. There is a physical split between the physiological body of the performer and other physical bodies in such performances. Bringing the example of your recent performance, Reclining Stickman, the liveness is produced by your physical body and the robot, activated remotely by other physical bodies, the audience, which in turn activate other physical spaces, my studio room, for example, from where I connected to participate to that performance. Bodies and bits of bodies specially separated but electronically connected can generate patterns of interactivity at varying scales and aesthetics and ethical issues of concern. For instance, at what level of interintelligent interactivity might a machine be considered at the same level as the human body? As you told me in a previous conversation we had, the human being and the machine working together, influencing each other, as well as the ability of a computer to respond to a user's input, may bring unexpected incremental developments, which will constantly shift and alter the ratios of interactivity between bodies and machines and its instruments and computers. May you please describe some of your performances that better outline the concept of interactivity?
The online body interactive performances begin with Fractal Flesh in 1995. This was for an event titled Telepolis. My body was in Luxembourg, but people in the Pompidou Centre in Paris, the Media Lab in Helsinki, the Doors of Perception in Amsterdam were able to access my body and remotely choreograph its movements, inadvertently composing the sounds that were generated. This was done via a touchscreen 3D model of the body, interfaced to a 6 degrees of freedom muscle stimulation system. This was a split body experience, not a split mind and body, but a split physicality. Voltage in, with the left-hand side performing involuntarily, and voltage out on the right-hand side, actuating a third hand. This is not about who is in control, but rather constructing a more complex performing body of multiple agency spanning remote spaces, an extended operational system. With Ping Body in 1996, using the Ping protocol, the reverberating signals from 30 global locations were measured in milliseconds and mapped to the body's muscles. Instead of people in other places moving the body, the internet activity itself animates the artist. Moving involuntarily, the body becomes a kind of crude barometer of internet activity. For Parasite in 1997, a customized search engine scans the internet, selects anatomical images from the web, and projects them into my head-up display. The image files are analyzed for their complexity. The anatomical images that I see are the images that move my body. The body is sustained and becomes parasitic to images and sounds online. The internet as a kind of external nervous system for the body. A 6 degree of freedom exoskeleton was engineered for the rewired, remixed performance for Radical Ecology's exhibition at the Perth Institute of Contemporary Art in 2016. For 5 days, 6 hours every day continuously, the body could only see with the eyes of someone in London, could only hear with the ears of someone in New York, whilst anyone, anywhere, could access the body's right arm via the online interface to the exoskeleton. Remote participants could see their choreography with the live streaming video. So this one body was in 3 places at the same time, virtually in London and New York, and physically in Perth. There was also engineered a robot installation with online interactivity for the 2020 Adelaide Biennial of Australian Art. Reclining Stickman is a 9 metre long, 4 metre high stick figure robot that continuously rotates on its axis. Its limbs are algorithmically actuated with pneumatic rubber muscles. Anyone, anywhere, at any time can access and choreograph the movements of the robot. For the 5-hour continuous performance, the body was positioned on the torso of the robot. The artist could animate the robot with a pair of pneumatic joysticks and improvise with in-gallery and online remote interactivity. I imagined the body on the robot as a kind of contemporary pietà of a human held by a large robot. But Nina Sellers more astutely described this as the body merely being a human strap-on for the robot.
In an interview in 2013, you said, "We are in a time of circulating flesh." I find this expression of yours fascinating, as if translating into a sentence you and artist Nina Sellers collaboration and performance blender, a highly sophisticated biorobotech installation.
Blender was a more radical alternative anatomical architecture. It was first exhibited for Technikunst in Melbourne in 2005. And was also exhibited at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Sydney for the exhibition New Romance, Art and the Post-Human in 2016. Blender was a collaboration with another artist, Nina Sellers. Both artists underwent liposuction and 4.6 litres of their biomaterial was inserted in a machine installation. This was the inverse of the stomach sculpture. Instead of a machine choreography, inside a soft organ of the body. Here, Blender is a machine installation that is the host for a liquid body composed of biomaterial from each artist. Proximity sensors arrayed in the chassis of the installation actuate the Blender blades whenever anyone gets close, mixing the biomaterial from the two artists' bodies. The pneumatic blade sounds and gurgling liquid sounds of the biomaterial were acoustically amplified. Blender was anthropomorphic in scale, approximating the height of the two artists.
The experimental aspect of Blender brings me to think of a fundamental concept regarding biomaterials, that of biocompatibility, which is the ability of a material to act by determining an appropriate host response in a given application, and so more broadly to genetic engineering, bioprocesses, and chemical molecular techniques to evaluate and modify the mechanisms involved in the cellular and molecular regulation of genes, proteins, and metabolites with biotechnological potential. Scientific progress, as it is happening, for example, regarding the development of research on embryos in the field of medically assisted procreation techniques, will inevitably lead us to reconsider the meaning of our existence, and thus of life and death, as we understand them today.
With in vitro fertilization and the prolonged preservation of frozen embryos, there is a desynchronization of human lifespan from our reproductive processes. You may be born when your twin is on her deathbed. You may be born from the body of another well after the death of your biological mother. And we are now approaching a time of neither birth nor death, when we engineer an artificial womb and bring to bear a healthy child, then life would not begin with a biological birth. And when we can replace malfunctioning components of the body with stem cell-grown organs, 3D bioprinted and artificial parts, then we need not die a biological death. So how do we define human existence, which neither begins with birth nor ends in death? In fact, we no longer die biological deaths. We die when our technological life support systems are switched off. And at any rate, Friedrich Nietzsche reminds us that the living are only a species of the dead.
Dearest Stelarc, heartily thank you for your precious time, profound insight, and for the clarity of your expression. Well, allow me to hug you at least in remote, and until next time, thank you.